County Public Library. But I'm just doing the introduction tonight. We have Lisa Henderson, and Lisa is a Mercy baby, born in Mercy Hospital, born and raised in Wilson, and her interest in genealogy was sparked by a fifth grade project doing a family tree. She holds a BA from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Go Heels! Hey, it's a rough year. I don't even want to see my family, they pulled for Duke. An MA from Columbia University and a JD from Harvard Law School, and is a practicing attorney. She maintains 3 genealogy and history blogs, and especially proud of the work she does at Black, White, and Wake. Basically, if you have not been on that site, go to it. It is wonderful. You can even search. I love the search feature. Which is dedicated to African American families in the history of Wilson County, North Carolina. Lisa also spearheads, which I know is near and dear to her heart, the Lane Street Project, a grassroots effort to reclaim and restore 3 of Wilson's historic African American cemeteries. So I am going to turn this over to Lisa.
Thanks so much, Tammy, for the introduction. First, as always, I want to thank Wilson County Public Library for inviting me to speak during Black History Month, and for steadfastly walking the walk of inclusion, especially in times like these, when holding space for the stories of all of us can invite criticism and cancellation. So thank you to Wilson County Public Library. Second, I want, as always, to thank my parents. I want to thank my mother, who is here. I want to thank my father, who is here.
Amen.
I had the great good fortune to grow up in a household in which Black history and culture were intentionally centered. Kindergarten prom, 1973. King College of Knowledge.
Oh, yeah.
It is not an accident that I am standing here on a February evening to talk to you about Samuel H. Vick. My parents filled our home and lives with books and toys and experiences that reflected us and affirmed us, and I can't see. And fostered pride in the foundational contributions of Black people to these United States. So I thank them, and I say to you, don't wait on anybody or anything, especially your government, to teach you about your history. Remember the principle of Sankofa and go back and get it. Now, Samuel H. Vick. I really struggled to know how to sort of plot a climb up the slopes of the mountain of this man. I could probably talk about Sam Vick for days and still not exhaust the topic. In the end, I decided that this lecture can only be an introduction to Sam Vick and his works, and rather than proceeding chronologically, I would set out the multiple narrative arcs of his life, any one of which could be a separate lecture and the subject of a master's thesis. Sam Vick was a one-man Black Wall Street and deserves both close study and high praise. So, roots in early years. Samuel H. Vick was born enslaved on April 1st, 1863 near Castalia. That's up here in Nash County. His father, Daniel Vick, was born about 1845, was the son of Winnie, perhaps Ida Parker, and most likely Josiah Vick, who was a wealthy slave owner. His mother, Fanny Blunt, was born about 1846 to Violet Blunt, who was born about 1820. So that gets his roots back to the very early 19th century. Shortly after the Civil War, Daniel Vick and Fanny Blunt moved to Wilson County. And on April 31st, 1866, they registered their 6-year marriage. In 1867, and this is a little bit of a side, but it just sort of tells you, it's an episode that tells you, I think, a bit about the kind of family that Sam Vick grew up in. In 1867, his grandmother, Violet Blunt, filed a complaint with the Freedmen's Bureau opposing the involuntary apprenticeship of her grandsons, Marcus and Oscar Blunt, to Benjamin H. Blunt, who had formerly owned Violet and Fanny and Fanny's children in Nash County. Marcus and Oscar's mother was Violet's daughter, Margaret, who was Fanny Blunt Vick's deceased sister. Violet named Daniel Vick as a suitable guardian for the boys, and Daniel and Fanny reared them in Wilson with their children, Samuel Hines Vick, Ernest Linwood Vick, Nettie Vick, William Henry Vick, and James Oscar Vick. In 1877, Daniel Vick, who was a carpenter, purchased 1 acre of land just east of Wilson town limits, his first recorded real estate acquisition. He went on to purchase additional land along what is now Martin Luther King Jr. Parkway and accumulated considerable wealth. His life foreshadowed his sons. He was a trustee of the Colored Greater Union, was appointed a federal mail carrier, developed real estate, and was active in local Republican politics. Fanny Blunt Vick died about at the very end, actually, of 1901. Daniel Vick died in 1908. Their headstone, which as you can see has been marred by bullet pockmarks, stands in Odd Fellows Cemetery today, in what was originally the Vick family plot. Wilson Academy, which seems to have been a private school, but it's not entirely clear, educated the first generation of free African-American children in Wilson. Sam Vick attended Wilson Academy and worked as a grocery clerk to pay his school fees. Wilson Academy was a graded school, however. It only had grades 1 through 8. And students who wished to go beyond 8th grade had to leave Wilson to attend high school. Vick was one of many who chose to attend Lincoln University outside Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. He was not the only child of his family to be educated. His brother William Henry Vick graduated from Lincoln in 1894, passed his pharmacy boards in 1897, and settled in New Jersey. James Oscar Vick attended Biddle University, which was later Johnson C. Smith in Charlotte, and became an AME, African Methodist Episcopal minister. And Frank Oscar Blunt, who was one of the boys that Violet Blunt had sought to protect, graduated in the same class at Lincoln with his cousin Sam Vick, and succeeded him as principal of the colored graded school. So Sam Vick returned to Wilson after graduation in 1884. This is probably him around, well this is him, it's probably around the time of his graduation. So this is one of the youngest pictures that we have of Sam Vick. In 1892, he married Annie M. Washington. She was a graduate of Scotia Seminary, now Barbara Scotia College in Concord, and was a teacher at the Colored Graded School. The couple had 9 children together: Elva Louise, Viola Leroy, Daniel Lionel, Samuel Hines Jr., George White, Irma Pauline, Robert Elliott, Doris Vivian, and Monty LaRoque. Now the two, the son Daniel obviously was named after Sam Vick's father, Sam Jr., and then the two younger sons, George White and Robert Elliott, were named for prominent African-American congressmen. George H. White, of course, was a congressman from North Carolina from the 2nd District, and Robert Brown Elliott was a congressman from South Carolina. This handsome portrait captures members of the extended family of Samuel Vick, Samuel and Annie Washington Vick, and appears to have been taken on the porch of their home at 622 East Green Street, roughly 1905. Vick himself is seated here, center left. The man seated beside him may be his father, Daniel Vick, who died in 1908. The seated boys are likely from left to from the left, George, Samuel, and Daniel. The identity of the girl is not clear. She's not daughter of Viola, who had passed already at this point. And the younger daughters, Irma, Doris, and Monty, had not yet been born. Nor was son Robert, who was the youngest of the boys. Eldest daughter, Elba Vick, may be the girl standing here. These may be brothers of Sam Vick, and this, I believe, is his wife, Annie Washington Vick. So now I'm going to go through, as I talked about, these sort of arcs, these arenas of activity in which Sam Vick had really just sort of foundational involvement in Wilson. So first, education, 1880s to the 1930s. Upon returning to Wilson in 1884, Sam Vick took a teaching position at the city's public colored graded school. Now this isn't actually the school that he, the building at which he taught. This is a later iteration of that building. But it was at this same site. If you know where White's Tire is at the corner of Pender and Hine Street, if you were to go down Pender about a block and a half and curve toward, I think that's Blackfeet Road, right in that corner, there are some apartment buildings now. That's, people still call it the schoolyard. That's because that's where the colored grade school was. So this building was built about in the 1890s, and he taught in the 1880s, but at that same location. After just a year teaching, he was promoted to principal of the school, and he maintained that position for about 4 years. And this earned him the title professor. So you always see a lot of references to him as Professor Vick, people calling him Professor Vick. It's a title, a term of respect that was awarded him because of his role at the colored graded school. So although he left the classroom while he was still in his 20s, Sam Vick remained active in education, serving as a member of the county's biracial Board of Education in the 1890s. It was kind of biracial as a fluke. This was the 1890s, if you recall, was a period of sort of tremendous political turmoil in North Carolina, where you had populist, fusionist, Democrats, Republicans, all sort of vying for power. And there's a blog post I have about it that really kind of sets out what happened. But essentially, at one point, there were two boards of education that were, one was elected, one was appointed. And the one that Sam Vick was on was the one that was recognized as the official board of education. So he was able to serve on a board of education for a while. He also served as trustee of Mary Potter Academy in Oxford. It was a girls' school. And of the Albion Academy in Franklinton, North Carolina. These were largely boarding schools. In this era, there were a number of these types of schools that were founded. You had the one up in, was it Bricks? Up in Halifax County, Enfield, around Enfield. You had several of these sorts of schools. Palmer Institute, outside of Greensboro and Sedalia, is one, is probably the most famous of them. But he was on the board of two of these institutions. In 1918, story I talked about last year, when the black community of Wilson boycotted the colored graded school to protest the mistreatment of one of its children, one of its teachers, Sam Vick offered one of his buildings, a two-story apartment house on Vance Street, as a site for a private community-supported school called the Wilson Normal and Industrial Institute. So this is the only known photograph of the Wilson Earl and Industrial Institute. It was also called the Training School. It was called the Independent School. It had been, strangely enough, it had been originally the property of the Methodist Church here on Green Street. Green Street, Methodist Church. Silas Lucas sold it to Sam Vick. He was using it as an apartment building, but he operated as an alternate school. And he served as chairman, see here, chairman of the board of directors of the school. Lots that I could say about this episode in Wilson history, which I regard as just really one of the most revolutionary acts to have occurred in this place. But it was one of the things that makes it interesting for me is that you have this real unity of Wilson's black working class and professional class at this time. So you've got primarily, the children of the school were primarily working class children. The principal of the school, who was implicated in the violent mistreatment of Mary Yule, who was a black teacher, he was a black principal. He, of course, was a part of Wilson's upper class, but his peers, Sam Vick, Dr. Phillips, this is William Phillips, who was a dentist, Dr. Perry, who was pastor of St. Mark, Reverend Davis, was pastor of First Missionary Baptist Church. They all took the side of the students, the parents that boycotted the school, and took the lead in establishing the school, which lasted about 10 years. So as a result of all of this sort of activity with education, it was fitting that in 1936, when Wilson built a new school on North Reed Street to relieve severe overcrowding at the colored graded school, it was named Samuel H. Vick Elementary. This was the first school named for an African American in Wilson County. So again, it opened in December 1936, with approximately 600 students were transferred from the old school. So I don't know how many were left at the old school, but 600 came to Sam Vick. And this, of course, is the original Sam Vick building here. This sort of eye-shaped piece. This piece in the back, which was the cafeteria. My father went to Sam Vick, and he talks about how when they started, they didn't have a cafeteria. And he remembers when they added it on. And he also remembers that you could buy your milk for a penny, and it came in these little bottles, and there was big, thick butter on the top, cream on the top, and they would just shake them. This is Sam Vick. Of course, now Sam Vick is a new school that occupies a new school building that occupies the site of a former Darden High School, which is just down the street, it's on Carroll, down Reed, and you get on Carroll. So this is Sam Vick's this is the arc of Sam Vick's involvement in education. Now, church leadership, 1880s to 1920s. While at Lincoln University, Sam Vick embraced Presbyterianism. He was instrumental in the founding of Wilson's Calvary Presbyterian Church in 1889. That is still an active church. It's active in the same location there at the corner of Green and Pender Streets that it was when Vick was there. And he spent decades as a missionary establishing Sunday schools at Presbyterian churches across eastern North Carolina. He also served on the executive committee of the North Carolina Colored Interdenominational Association. So here we have a picture, not sure of the date, but we know it was before 1824, because this, I believe, is the original wooden church that Calvary occupied. So this is him, of course, in the corner, and these are Sunday school children. And then we have Calvary's second building, beautiful brick building that stood again at the corner of Green and Pender, and was built by members of the congregation who were incredible brick masons and craftsmen. And these are, this is shortly after the opening of the building, and these are, of course, members of the church. So now we move from church leadership to perhaps the area of involvement that, in which, I guess you could argue that Sam Vick had the most impact, and that was the political arena. So Daniel Vick, his father, was active in local Republican Party politics. Of course, this is an era in which the Republican Party was at least nominally a party that was identified with offering black voters or black citizens, rather, a voice. The Democrats were sort of the traditional party. After Reconstruction, there was not, if there ever had been, there certainly was not a home for black Americans in the Democratic Party. So until the 1930s, just about any African American who could vote was a Republican. And certainly Daniel Vick was, and his son followed in his father's footsteps when he returned to Wilson. So North Carolina's so-called black second congressional district was a fertile field for African American political activity, electing four black men to the U.S. House of Representatives before 1900. Sam Vick quickly rose to the upper echelon of the district's black power brokers, eventually becoming a close ally of future Congressman George H. White. So George White was the fourth congressman elected in the black second, and the last African-American to represent North Carolina in the U.S. House of Representatives until 1992. He left office in 1901. In 1889, President Benjamin Harrison appointed Vick as postmaster of Wilson. So this is an article from the Wilmington Morning Star that announces the confirmation in January of 1890. Postmaster positions were highly sought after, as they were among the few patronage jobs that were available in the rural areas, such as Wilson County. And Vick's appointment was bitterly resented. However, he was, by all accounts, very successful in the job, treated everyone fairly, and was well regarded in the position. He remained as postmaster until 1894. There was the election that year, there was a regime change, a Democrat came in, and of course he lost the position. But in 1898, President William McKinley reappointed him. In 1903, now we've got the election of Teddy Roosevelt. Vick Teddy Roosevelt had promised that he would not take race into consideration in deciding appointments or deciding whether to continue appointments. And of course, the past practice was that if a person was in an office, had been appointed by the party that was in power, then the person remained in these patronage positions. However, Jeter Pritchard, who was a congressman from North Carolina, in fact, was the only Republican senator from the South at that time, was a leader of the so-called Lily White movement. And these were Republicans who had decided that, maybe I can remember. It's a little interesting. Jeter Pritchard, just a few years before, had really been a champion of black political participation. Jeter Pritchard had been on the right side, for example, of the response to the Wilmington massacre. But Jeter Pritchard, I guess, read the you know, read the winds, read the tea leaves, and joined the Lilywhites. And the idea was that that Teddy Roosevelt should sort of prove himself, prove his commitment to Republicans and get rid of Sam Vick. So though there was really no one had any quarrel with Sam Vick's, with the way he had carried out his job, they trumped up essentially an excuse to dismiss him. And what they said was they found that if they looked in the voting results for some elected position, and they found that only one person had cast a vote for this person, one Republican had cast a vote. And a white man came forward and said, well, I cast the vote. That was my vote. So the idea was, well, if this person cast the vote, then Sam Vick could not have cast the vote. Sam Vick said he did. They said he didn't. He's disloyal. He's disloyal to the party. And so because he had been disloyal to the Republican Party, he was removed from the postmaster position. This sounds like, well, you know, okay, whatever. Now, it was huge at the time. This was covered across the country. There were news articles sort of following, what is Teddy Roosevelt going to do? How is this going to play out? And so again, ultimately, Sam Vick left that office. Even after his removal as postmaster, however, he remained politically active. In 1904, he was elected a delegate to the Republican National Convention from North Carolina's 2nd District. But in 1908, white Republicans in North Carolina froze out the black delegates. And this led black Republicans to sort of form their own committee and to proffer basically shadow delegates, who of course were not seated, but they were, you know, they proffered them. With the Lilywhites firmly in control for the next several decades, black Republicans were locked out of seceding conventions, and this led Vick to, this is, let's back up a little bit. This is a slide out from, what was it? Clinton, Alabama is reporting on this. Which is, there is some irony that seems to Alabama have anything to say about what was happening. But it's actually a sympathetic, I don't know the Union Banner, maybe I'm not giving them credit, but it's a sympathetic account of essentially the way Sam Vick was done dirty in being removed from that position. So here's the Wilson Daily Times, June 14th, 1920. Professor Vick of this city attended the Chicago Convention and presented a notice to the contest committee stating that the Republican Convention in the state excluded Negroes from its councils. So as late as 1920, he is still attempting to take an active part in politics and to demand a role in the party that of his choice. Civic life. Sam Vick was a founding or early member of the lodges of several African American fraternal organizations in Wilson, including the Knights of Labor, the Knights of Pythias, Mount Hebron, Lodge Number 42. This is the most beautiful photograph almost that I've ever seen. It's Mount Hebron Lodge standing outside of St. John. So St. John is under construction, which dates this to 1913, 14, somewhere in there. So we've got Sam Vick right here. We've got Charles Henry Darden right here. We've got C.L. Darden, his son, right here. We've got William Hines. Right here. Who else? brother. Tracy Ellis, Leon, does that brother look like Leon Barnes?
Yes.
I think that's his grandfather.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah.
That's my grandfather. There's this was Charlie Thomas. This was one of these is John McBarnes, one of these is this is John McBarnes. This is Short Barnes. This is Reverend B. P. Coward, who was pastor at Calvary or Amazon? Who's Amazon? St. John. So anyway, this is really literally a who's who of black male Wilson anyway at the time. And then what I love is really all of these little kids, all in the back, and there are actually a couple of women over on the edge. Like you see these big plumes and this hat and some kids. I don't know masonry, but I know that a lot of these men are obviously officers. They're wearing their badges of that indicate the offices that they are holding. But it's interesting to me that like I said, he's right in the center there, kind of pride of place. He was also a member of Omega Psi Phi fraternity. And perhaps most notably, what seems to be most important to him, he was a member of Hannibal Lodge number 1552 of the Grand United Order of Odd Fellows. He was active not only in the local Odd Fellows Lodge, but held for decades, held positions at the state level with the Odd Fellows. He even built a three-story building, which I ought to remember this building better. It was sort of in the middle of, not really the middle, but more toward the Pender Street end of the 500 block of Nash Street. It's now a parking lot. Or actually, I think it's where the extension of Jackson Chapel is. But it was a three-story building that he built. The lodge met on its upper floor. The building burned in 1997. This is a photo from the Wilson Daily Times, and it reads, Hannibal Lodge, number 1552, GUO, Grand United Order of Odd Fellows, organized September 19, 1873. So this is one of the first African-American fraternal organizations organized in Wilson County. And this building was dedicated September 19, 1894, when Samuel would have been 31 years old, and he built this building. And we have the three links of the Odd Fellows, FLT, Friendship, Love, Truth. So this, again, it housed their meeting hall, and then of course he sold or donated, it's not clear because we don't have the deed, the land around his family cemetery to create the Odd Fellows Cemetery. Vick was also a leader in civic organizations like the Emancipation Proclamation Association. This group organized annual January 1st celebrations of the Emancipation Proclamation. And he was a founding member of the Wilson County Industrial Association, which sponsored fairs that showcased the goods, the talents of businessmen, of farmers, African-American businessmen and farmers. And during World War I, he was one of the leaders of the state, the North Carolina War Savings Campaign, sort of going around getting people to donate to the war effort. In November 1910, when Booker T. Washington scheduled a stop in Wilson during his southern tour, Samuel and Annie Vick played host to the guest of honor, sponsoring a reception for Washington's entourage on their front lawn. Booker T. Washington spoke at the Colored Graded School, and Sam Vick was master of ceremony. So as you see this picture, everyone is numbered here. If you go to my blog, to Black White Lake, there is a post that sort of tells who everybody is in these pictures, but in here, but Sam Vick here is here. And of course, this is Booker T. Washington. And a lot of these men are, again, people who traveled with him on this tour. So they were not Wilsonians. Of course, this was an era where there was, there really weren't a hotel. There was a hotel. There was a Hotel Orange. But it would not have been suitable to house these dignitaries. So these men were kind of farmed out across middle class Black Wilson, you know, and so you put up two or three people, and somebody else would put up two or three people. And the Vicks had a 16-room house, so I'm sure they put up the most, you know, folks. But it was really kind of an amazing day. I know that's C.L. Darden here. I think beside him, this is Walter Hines. William Hines is somewhere in here. Anyway, so yeah, lots of, it's just really an amazing shot and an amazing, amazing moment. So that's November 1910. Now, how is it that Sam Vick gets to do this? Yes, he was a postmaster. But what really, you know, was sort of going on? He did not attend Tuskegee. The actual sort of link to Tuskegee was Oliver Freeman, who had attended Tuskegee. And also Dr. Elijah L. Reed, who was Wilson's first Black veterinarian. He had also attended, had been trained at Tuskegee. So those were the Tuskegee links. I suspect the big link, and Sam Vick had plenty of money. And largely, it was here real estate. So Sam Vick began to accumulate real estate while he was in his early 20s. He bought several commercial lots in downtown Wilson, some west of the tracks, some east of the tracks. He owned a fair amount of property clustered in the 500 block. He bought large tracts of land east of present Highway 301. He bought a big chunk of property between sort of Pender Street and sort of North Pender and East Nash and 301, kind of that rectangle there. He bought another big chunk down sort of below where the colored graded school was, sort of Stansburg Road, Black Creek Road, Hadley Street, I don't even know the names of all the streets, but all, you know, over Lincoln Street, all in there. He owned a lot of property there. He also owned property in other cities, Rocky Mount, Raleigh, Goldsboro, Charlotte. During this period, he also began building and buying rental houses across East Wilson. He built scores of shotgun houses. The shotgun houses that, for a period, there are relatively few left now. But even in my childhood, there were some streets where there were just ranks, just rows and rows and rows of shotgun houses, and those were built by Sam Vick as rental properties. In the 1890s, Sam Vick and his wife Annie almost single-handedly developed the 600 and 700 blocks of East Green Street as basically Wilson's premier address for middle class Black people. He sold lots to his friends and to his family members. This is a deed. This is 1898. It's just one of dozens. And this is a lot that he sold to Samuel Gay. This would have been, the house is still there that was built. I think it's 623 East Green. So he sold this lot. Most of the lots he sold, let's see the price on this one, but no, where is it? $100. Sam Vick developed. He laid out streets across East Wilson, naming them after his family. Of course, there's Vick Street. There's Viola Street. Before Viola Street was Viola Street, it was a tiny, it was an alley. I mean, if you notice now, if you go down Vick Street, it's narrower than Green or than Vance. It was an alley. It was called Pig Alley. He expanded it, developed it, built a lot of rental houses. Houses actually owned by Viola. But also Elba Street was named after a daughter. Irma Street was named after one of his daughters. Doris Street, none of us remember Doris because it's now Powell Street, but that was named after a daughter. He also named Reed Street after J.D. Reed, who was his business associate. He named streets after men he admired, like Booker T. Washington. Washington Street was originally Booker T. Washington Street. Atlantic Street was originally Atlanta Street, after Booker T. Washington's famous address at the convention in 1896 in Atlanta. He also named, for example, the original name of Elvie Street was Elliott Street, after Robert Elliott, for whom he also named his son. Sam Vick planted trees throughout the neighborhood, including a row of oaks down the middle of Green Street. And by 1905, he had built an imposing 16-room slate roof mansion at 622. This building, this house still stands, of course. It's somewhat modified now. It doesn't have a lot of the really ornate drawn blank. Millwork. A lot of the millwork is gone. The porches are gone. But it was in this yard that Booker T. Washington and those gentlemen were gathered. And this fence or wall is actually still there, at least partially. And there's some big old trees in the front. I don't know if these are there. So this is the Vick House, which, you know, was obviously the jewel of the block. So this is a 1908 a detail from a bird's eye map of Wilson, 1908. So this was Green Street here, and this is Pender down here. So this huge over the whole block, that's the Vick mansion. The house that's next door to it, is what hadn't been built yet. That one house was occupied by Dr. Frank Hargrave, who founded with Vick, we'll talk about that in a minute, Wilson Hospital, later known as Mercy Hospital. He married Sam Vick's cousin, Bessie Parker, and they lived next door. But he developed these blocks, again, for his friends. He also developed He sold lots to churches. So this church, which is still there, not in its original form, was Pilgrim Rest, Primitive Baptist Church. This church here is Piney Grove, which looks enormous in this photo. I've never seen a photo of the original Piney Grove. Piney Grove is still active too, but not in this location. This, of course, down here was Calvary. So you could already see by 1908 kind of the fruit of Sam Vick's work, of his efforts to create, sort of build this community out of nothing. Not quite as nothing as this appears. There were houses right here, but you really get a sense of what he accomplished. By 1901, Sam Vick had invested heavily in Whitesboro, New Jersey, which was a development in southern New Jersey, which touted itself as a self-reliant community for blacks, free from the discrimination that they faced in the South. Former Congressman George White's Realty Company marketed the project, and Sam Vick was president of the development company. He also bought a tremendous amount of lots and marketed his own
letter of recommendation, actually much later. So 1901 is when this got started. This is 1923. He's still involved. He's still, you know, trying to sell some of these lots. Whitesboro arguably failed as the type of community that George White set out to create, but it is a town still in South Jersey. The name, what's his last name? Stedman, Oprah Stedman. Stedman Graham. Yeah. Stedman Graham is from Whitesboro, and Stedman Graham is a member of the Spalding family. So is George White. So the members of that family moved into that area. So it's still there as a community, but it did not become the haven that they had expected or they had hoped for it to be. Back in Wilson, Sam Vick was marketing property in what he called the Winona subdivision, 1905. This map is a little hard to see. It's kind of upside down. But this is Mercer Street. And over here, which is labeled on this map, I think it's called Daniel's Mill, is Fairview Street, if you know Fairview. So he owned this section there between sort of Fairview and Hominy Swamp Canal. And he marketed these lots and sold them primarily to African American homeowners, but also investors who built rental property. In 1913, he sold the city of Wilson 8 acres just east of the town of Wilson to establish a new public cemetery for African Americans. We now know the cemetery is Vick Cemetery. It wasn't called that then. It was just the colored cemetery. It was active for about 40 years before the city condemned it, allowed it to lapse into disrepair. I'll take this moment to plug Lane Street Project. This is what we do. This is what we are focused on. It's the reclamation of, there are actually 3 cemeteries here. There's Vick Cemetery, which was a public cemetery. There's Oddfellows, which had been originally the Vick family's cemetery and was sold to the Oddfellows fraternity. And then in this little sliver between the creek here, right in there, is Roundtree Missionary Baptist Church Cemetery. Roundtree Church is up here. So these three, when I was growing up, we always thought of it just as Roundtree, like one name, Roundtree. There's actually 3 cemeteries, 3 very different stories. But we are out there, we'll be out there Saturday, trying to kind of beat back some of this, and just really sort of restore dignity to these sacred spaces, restore recognition of them as places that, you know, in which our ancestors lie and that should be honored. Back to the message. So, as seen here in this article, and this is from 1916, it's an article in Marburg, North Carolina, that picks up an article on paper called the Wilson Dispatch. Vick's wealth, especially his real estate wealth, was widely touted. He was regarded as perhaps the wealthiest Negro in North Carolina. They list his how many lots he owned, his tax assessment. This article isn't entirely accurate, but talks about his father. His father had died 8 years before. Talking about his father's property, which practically belongs to Sam. I don't know why that would be true. Sam Vick had siblings who probably inherited as well. But anyway, he owns a house and 2 vacant lots in Raleigh. His individual holdings in Whitesboro. He owns proximity, on and on and on. And this is not the only article like this. There were many others that we talked about. Just what an amazing wealth he had accumulated. So in 1925, in what appears to have been perhaps his last major real estate move, a surveyor to lay out several hundred lots on a large tract of land southeast of downtown Wilson. This subdivision was called Vicksburg Manor, and its lots were marketed to developers and rental plans buyers. So here we have, this is a little hard to read. This is Stantonsburg Street. So this, okay, here we have Elliott, which is that LV. A lot of these names have changed. So this is no longer Masonic Avenue. I think that's Lincoln. Is Lincoln right below LV? Okay, so this is now Lincoln. Dudley Street. I can't read that. Here's Irma, named after his daughter. There's a Duncan. And this is what I think became what the code there. So anyway, this big sort of rumbleway was the last big chunk of Sam Vick's property that was marketed. The lots were drawn off as 25-foot lots. They weren't always sold that way, some of them are larger. But that area, if you actually look on like Google Maps now, at the right sort of magnification, the term Vicksburg Manor will pop up as the name of the plat. And so he's still sort of remembered in the landscape in that way. So this is in the major source of Sam Vick's wealth is money generated from his property. And of course, in order to buy this property, he had to have other income streams. So side by side with his real estate development, he developed or invested in an astonishing number of businesses in Wilson. So in 1906, he built the Orange Hotel. It was originally intended as accommodation for African Americans sort of arriving in town on the train, stay on the train. It's just a block, block and a half east of the ACL railroad rail station. It did not have a long life as a hotel. It quickly became a boarding house. It became a boarding house with extras. let's call it a pleasure palace. That's what we're going to call it. But it's really a beautiful building, even now. It's not in really great shape now, but it's got, if you go by there now, it's still got the original brackets on these, turned porch posts. These windows are enormous. They're like 7 feet tall. I don't think much of the inside is original anymore, but sort of one of the chimneys is missing. But it's really just a lovely hotel. And it's this type of hotel, these sort of wooden hotels. There were several along Nash Street, mostly catered to white travelers. But it's the last one that's standing. All of the others have been torn down. So, shout out to the Orange Hotel.
Right door and all.
Yeah, exactly, right? If you wanted some titillating stories, search Orange Hotel. So then we saw earlier that Sam Vick had built this three-story building to lodge the Oddfellows. Well, this is a postcard produced in 1923, mid-1920s, that shows the 500 block of East Nash Street looking west. So basically, if you're standing here, you'd be standing roughly at kind of the back edge of Jackson Chapel. And this is Cherry Hotel. So you're looking down the street. And if you notice over here, I'm not entirely sure that this is But this was residential. Most of this side of the block, most of the south side of the block was residential. And if you think about it now, that's what's over there, they're houses.
Mm-hmm.
There are a couple of little buildings like Dr. Roseman's old dentist office. There's a barber shop that was Dr. Phillips' office. But most of this was residential until you got further down where, say, for example, Pep's barbershop, that area, that was commercial buildings. But this is the building that Sam Vick built for the Odd Fellows.
Mm-hmm.
And if you see here, here's this little sign, Globe, Globe Theater was on the second floor here. It started off as a vaudeville theater, and then it became, by the 1920s, it was a moving picture theater. But there are ads, really amazing ads, touting some of the acts that came through. For example, Mamie Smith, blues woman, played the Globe. You know, others, if you notice here, this was another hotel. So the Orange wasn't the only one. This was a hotel here. It wasn't Sam Vick's. There's another sign here, Maynard Fish Market. I think that was a white-owned business. But it was really just a vibrant block, and Sam Vick's hotel really was sort of the center of business here. And again, it would seem to me that I should remember this building more because it stood until 1997. But I guess it's like anything, if you just, you know, if it's just part of your landscape, you don't necessarily pay attention to things. So in 1913, Sam Vick and Frank Hargrave, Dr. Frank Hargrave, who was a native of Lexington, North Carolina, opened Wilson Hospital. There were two components to Wilson, to this hospital. There was the Wilson Hospital, and then there was the Tubercular Park, which was going to be built a little ways outside of town. Sam Vick bought a big lot, a big parcel of property. That's been credited to Frank Hargrave, but I did a little digging around in Register of Deeds yesterday, and actually Sam Vick that 40-acre parcel that the Tubercular Home was going to be built on. It was not ever built. It was somewhere, kind of the best I can tell by the description, somewhere in the vicinity of what was then, what is it now? Barnes Chapel, sort of below off Railroad Street. In that, what is it, like Cemetery Street, Elby Street, back in there, somewhere in there, because it was near. It was near Hominy Swamp and the Norfolk Southern Railway and the ACL Railway, so somewhere in that area. So anyway, this is Wilson Hospital. I was born there. As Tammy mentioned, I was among the last children born there. It closed in 1964, but up between 1913 and 1964, treated African Americans from across northeastern North Carolina. It was the only black hospital east of Raleigh for decades. It was one of only three in the state when it opened. It had a black staff. As you can see, these are nurses here. It had a series of black doctors, Dr. Michener, Dr. Cowan, was a staff doctor there, and then later on, more toward integration. Well, actually, the entire time, white doctors had practicing privileges at Mercy. They could come and treat a patient there. And then toward integration, toward the period of integration, you would see more white doctors coming over to Mercy to practice. But what would typically happen, Mercy had a surgical theater, but for certain types of surgeries, ones that its doctors could not perform, the patient would be taken from Mercy to Carolina General or to Woodard Herring for surgery, and then would be brought back to Mercy for recovery. So that was just, you know. Lord knows what would happen to you on the way. He said, factor that into your recovery, to your diagnosis, what was going to happen to you in transit. So that's 1913. Sambic also helped incorporate two insurance or death benefit companies. One was Lincoln Benefit. The other was a company called Carolina Mutual Life Insurance, which is a little odd because it's very similar to North Carolina Mutual Life Insurance, which he worked with later on. But I found a reference to the incorporation of Carolina Mutual, and it was Sam Vick and James Shepherd. If any of you are North Carolina Central graduates, you know James Shepherd was a founder of North Carolina Central. So they went into business in with that insurance company. I don't really know how long it lasted. Shepherd was also involved in the founding of North Carolina Mutual as well. Sam Vick owned a livery stable in downtown Wilson. He had at least three farms. His tenant farmers, grew tobacco. They grew food crops. My grandmother told me a story. You could go to their house, and his wife sort of knock on the back, and they sold milk. They sold fresh milk to their neighbors because they had dairy cows out in the country, and their employees would go pick up milk and bring it into town, and she would dip it into your bottles, and that's how all the people got fresh milk in East Wilson. And as another measure, this is an interesting little thing I found, of Vick's wealth. In 1919, the North Carolina Secretary of State's office published this big, thick volume that listed the first 1,112 motor vehicles. No, 112,000 motor vehicles registered in the state. So this is the first 112,000 cars, 1919. Not surprisingly, Sam Vick was an early adopter. He registered the 685th through 689th cars. And if you notice, four different models, right? Chen, Arturo, two Hudsons. In December 1920, Sam Vick and four more of Wilson's leading African-American citizens executed a certificate of incorporation to establish the Commercial Bank of Wilson, so black-owned bank. It was stood at the corner, this building stood at the corner of East Nash and Pettigrew Streets, they were right on that corner, across from the Texas Inn. The bank was necessary, they asserted, to promote thrift and economy, to encourage agricultural and industrial enterprises, and to place in circulation money otherwise unavailable. And Vick was named there as its first president. Commercial Bank was in business for just under 10 years. It collapsed just at the beginning of the Depression. Not because of the Depression, but because of, unfortunately, shadiness by, I don't think you're listening here. managers, bank officers. Basically Robin Peter to pay Paul. And when there was an audit, and when the auditors arrived, they were like, why are there ashes in the bank vault? And And that triggered a huge audit. And as a result, folks went to prison. But also as a result, thousands of investors in East Wilson lost their lives. And many people refused for decades to bank formally because of the experience with commercial banking. It was a devastating incident. So we're now, again, we're in the 1920s. Sam Vick is now in his 60s. The Depression starts in the late 1920s. And in the middle of that period, drag on a little bit, in the mid-1930s, sort of the height of the Depression, the Vicks suffered a devastating setback financially when they lost nearly all of their property to foreclosure. By then, Sam Vick was in his 70s and he retreated from public life. What happened, not uncommon for people who were who owned lots of real estate during the Depression. They were what was called land poor. Lots of property, no cash. So there are articles, I found an article in the paper about, and there's it's sort of written with a little bit of a feeling of, you know, schadenfreude, a little bit of a glee, in which Sam Vick owed thousands of dollars of money in not only taxes, property taxes, but he owed a tremendous water bill to the city. He paid his tenants' water bills. They didn't, he provided the utilities as part of their rent. He could not pay, the tenants couldn't pay him because they're not working, it's a depression. Without the rental income, he couldn't pay the tax bills. People's water was cut off. So it just, you know, it all spiraled. And Sam Vick's loans, he financed a lot of his real estate purchases. And obviously, you know, something like the Depression, it's kind of like, with the pandemic a couple of years ago, right? Everybody gets squeezed. So the workers are squeezed, the landlord gets squeezed, the landlord's creditors get squeezed. Everybody wants their money. And when people started calling in Sam Vick's loans, when the trustees started calling his loans, he couldn't pay. And he lost, he even lost his house. His family was able to buy that back, but on a single day, a couple of days, 101, I think it is, properties left the Vick's hands and went to auction. So that was in 1935. So Sam Vick passed away on July 8th, 1946. He was buried in the family plot at Oddfellows, and a modest marker was placed at the head of his grave. On it was engraved Samuel H. Vick. He was faithful and upright in all his works. In 1952, Annie Vick was buried next to her husband. In 2013, Wilson County Historical Association collaborated with the Vick family to erect a marker commemorating Sam Vick's life. It was the first in Wilson dedicated to an African American. It's placed very close to his beloved Calvary Presbyterian, just off the block from his house. At the time that this marker was erected, no one really knew where Sam Vick's grave was, not even his family, his remaining family at that time. As the Oddfellows, of course, as the Oddfellows lodge membership aged, and as their numbers shrank, the Oddfellows Cemetery fell into disrepair and was overgrown. By 2020, only his daughter Irma Vick's headstone was visible. But in December of that year, volunteers with Lane Street Project located Samuel Vick's headstone, and we pledge to maintain it with respect going forward. So this is Samuel Vick's headstone. What I love about it, I love many things about it, but one thing I love about it is this headstone was made by a man named Clarence Best. It's hard to just see it from this one example, but if you go to grave cemeteries, you start to notice this man's particular style. Mm-hmm. So if you look at his nines, they all have this like long kind of tail. The sixes kind of have shoot out this way. He would typically put a little, you know, his whatever the carving was, it would be at the bottom, but often kind of idiosyncratic, maybe not quite centered, whatever. But it's really quite a, if you look at the body of his work, this one isn't engraved, but lots of them have flowers and Masonic symbols, and it's just a really beautiful folk craft. And I think one of sort of Wilson's unsung artists. Yeah, I'm sorry, that's an aside. But so we have found Sam Vick's final resting place, and we're gonna keep it clear. When I started talking tonight, I described Sam Vick as a one-man Black Wall Street. But he was so much more than that. There was no arena of social or civic life in which Sam Vick did not blaze trails, knock down walls, or burst through ceilings. Every day, we follow paths that he literally mapped out across Wilson. So thank you for the opportunity to shine a light on Sam Vick's life and his works. I mean, he is mentioned in Charles McKinney's work about the civil rights era in Wilson, but not much, because that book really focuses on a later period. He is mentioned, of course, in Patrick Valentine's history of Wilson, but there's not, you know, to really kind of understand even what happened with him and the postmaster position, you've just got pieced together like newspaper accounts. His life has not been examined. As I said, it's a doctoral thesis waiting to happen. You know, absolutely.
You should write a book, Lisa.
Yes.
let me add that. As I press the city of Wilson to acknowledge Vick Cemetery as the historic public cemetery that it is, certainly I think there is a place there for some sort of interpretive signage, and to the extent that Vick was integrally involved in establishing that cemetery, absolutely there should be.